Hi everyone, nice to see you again. Kind of see you, I guess. This video is going to talk about the second lecture of our cognition unit. Specifically, it's going to talk about language and how language can influence the way that we think. Just a little bit of a heads up as far as our schedule goes. This is the second of two lectures for cognition. So after this lecture, you can expect we're going to do kind of an activity after this, and then I plan on having a quiz toward the end of the week that covers information from this lecture and the last lecture I did on thinking and problem solving. Next week, our plan is to do our final two lectures, and those lectures are over intelligence, specifically intelligence theory, and then assessing intelligence. We'll then have kind of a quiz over those two things, and then we're going to start reviewing for the AP test. Next week, the College Board is supposed to get back to us with some more specific information about the AP exam, so I will be sure to pass that along to you as soon as I find out. We do know that the format of the test is going to look different this year. We know that the content, although the content is going to be, it's AP Psych, the way that they assess it will be a little different. So I'll be sure to pass that along as soon as I figure it out. But today, language and how we think. So this slide looks at the way that we develop language over time. I have some benchmarks on this slide. Recognize that those are averages, and some people may end up talking well before their peers. Some people, their language development is delayed. And so just keep in mind there's always outliers to these milestones that we see. But the first way that we communicate when we are infants is we cry. There was a woman named Elizabeth Dunstan in Australia, and she chose the somewhat odd profession of studying children crying every day, which sounds awful to me. But she believes that all babies essentially cry the same way, regardless of where they live, regardless of the language spoken at home, and that we have this kind of universal crying for things like when we're hungry, when we're sleepy, when we're gassy, and things like that. And then what starts to happen is we start cooing, which is an actual psych term. And with cooing, it's when infants realize that they can create sounds with their vocal cords in their mouth other than cries. And so these are kind of the cute little sounds that you sometimes hear, you know, 1 and 2 month old infants creating. What's interesting about cooing is it's also not language specific. And what I mean by that is if you have an infant where the language spoken at home is Spanish or French or German or English or Mandarin, the cooing will sound the same regardless of where that baby lives and the language that they hear. Infants do start to show what's called receptive language in this first stage. And receptive language is what you may anticipate it is. It's your ability to hear language and understand what that means. And so infants as young as 3 or 4 months old may recognize words like bottle, like mommy, puppy, things like that, where they hear these certain words and they begin to show an understanding of what that means. You know, if they're tired and they understand what it means, you know, crib, what that means. And so they start to calm down knowing that they're about to take a nap. In the next stage, this is the babbling stage, and students sometimes confuse cooing and babbling because they sound like kind of these funny words that don't actually carry meaning, but they do. Babbling is a specific stage in language development. And with babbling, what happens is infants begin to actually produce the sounds that they hear at home. And so they begin using what are called phonemes. And phonemes are simply the basic sounds of language. And so you can think back to kindergarten and first grade, and when you're learning the alphabet and you learn the sound that the letter B makes, you learn the sounds that are created when you put letters together. So when you put TH and SH and CH together, you create new basic sounds. And all those basic sounds are called phonemes. You simply put phonemes together to create words. And during the babbling stage, infants begin using the phonemes of their home language. And so the English language has around 40 phonemes. All words in the English language are made up of combinations of right around 40 basic sounds. 26 letters, but obviously some letters have multiple sounds. And again, if we put letters together, they create unique sounds as well. And so this is the very beginning of what's called productive language. Productive language is your ability to produce language to communicate. And so it might simply be ba 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 when they want a bottle, right? When a baby wants a bottle, or muh 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 when they are looking for their mother. And so it's just the beginning of these basic sounds to try to communicate a message that they have. Around the first birthday, infants are now able to take basic phonemes and start to put them together to create single words. For most babies, right around their first birthday is when they produce their first words, and that vocabulary will start to pick up quite rapidly. But when infants go for their first checkup at 1 year, doctors are often looking for a vocabulary of between 5 and 10 words. And then in the next 6 to 12 months, we have what's called telegraphic speech. And telegraphic speech would be two or three words that we put together that communicates a message, but it's not grammatically correct. So more Cheerios now, right? Or dog ate toy. So you know what the message is, but it's not grammatically correct. It's like a telegram that used to be sent, right? When they would take out the unnecessary words to save money. Babies aren't trying to save money. They just don't know those other words yet. And then finally, by their second birthday, we have full, I have in quotes there, complex sentences. But by 2 years old, a lot of toddlers at this point are running around with complete sentences and able to communicate with others. Some of the language complexities, things that we learned through observation and then later through schooling. Morphemes. Try not to confuse morphemes with phonemes. Again, phonemes are basic sounds of language. Morphemes are going to be the different grammatical rules that we pick up with language. And so morphemes are going to be units of speech. One way to think of it is this, is you learn a word and then you learn different ways to manipulate that word, right? Different things that you can add to that word to change it. And so if you're trying to make a word plural, if you're trying to make a word past tense, then we can manipulate morpheme. You can think manipulate those words. And so I have there the example undetermined, right? You have determine, and then you can add this kind of prefix, the UN as a prefix, you can add a D as a suffix, and you have these different units of speech. So they're in the word undetermined, you have three morphemes. Don't be confused and think, well, how many words can I find in this, right? Like, for example, you can find the word mine, but that's a different word that has nothing to do with kind of our root word. So morphemes is just how can we manipulate a particular word in our language. And it helps explain what's called overgeneralization. As children are picking up on morphemes just through exposure, they sometimes use them incorrectly. For example, a lot of times if we're saying something is past tense, we'll add an ED at the end, but that doesn't always make sense, right? Sometimes if we're making something plural, we'll add an S at the end, but that doesn't always make sense either. And so you get these kind of funny sentences that kids say, like, I goed to the park and petted the geeses. That doesn't make any sense, right? But it's overgeneralization. They're taking some of these rules that we have and they're overgeneralizing them. Syntax is the ability to put words in the correct order. And this is dependent on the language often spoken at home. Syntax is really fascinating because as we learn vocabulary at a very, very young age in telegraphic speech, children are starting to figure out what words should come first, second, third in a sentence, even without someone explicitly telling them. There's a linguist named Noam Chomsky, and he talks about how our brain is primed to learn language. It's what he calls the language acquisition device. Again, our mind is ready to learn language. Language is incredibly complex. In fact, some theorists would say that learning a language is actually more complicated than learning something like calculus. The difference is that our brain is primed and ready to learn language to the point where when we are just a few years old, we've got a pretty strong grasp on it. Whereas with something like calculus, you can be 15, 16, 25 years old, and it's still pretty complicated. Chomsky would say it's because our brain is hardwired to learn language and pick up things like syntax, which would be word order. And then semantics, I always think the stuff you learn in school, right? Remember semantic learning, semantic memory from our first unit. Those are the facts that you learn in school, things that you can look up online. Semantics, here's that same word again. Semantics in regard to language, think word meaning. What is the difference between two, two, and two? What's the difference between there, there, and there? Those are the semantics that you often learn in grade school and that take some more explicit education to pick up on. This slide really looks at how language impacts the way that we think. And you might come across one of two different phrases here. One's called what we call linguistic relativity, or we also have linguistic determinism. Linguistic determinism is a type of linguistic relativity. You don't need to differentiate those two for an AP Psych class. This is not a linguistics class. So you might see one of those two different ones. But the big thing that you should know for this class is simply this idea that when we think in language. It impacts the way that we perceive the world. I have a picture of snow on the slide, and you've maybe heard this concept where Eskimos have dozens and dozens of different words to describe snow. And because of that, they can think about snow differently, where you and I, we may just think, oh, there's snow, and it impacts how we think. We don't have the vocabulary to think about it differently. Another way to conceptualize that would be to think about love. When we talked about Sternberg and the triangular theory of love, he mentions the downfall that our language really doesn't have great words to differentiate between the way that we love a spouse, a sibling, a friend, a parent. We just use the word love. We use the word love to describe how much we love a breakfast burrito. And so we are limited in our language, and it therefore causes us to think differently because of it. There were some experimenters that had participants come in and describe a key, like a house key. But some of those participants were Spanish-speaking participants, and some of them were German-speaking participants. And what's really fascinating is that with German and Spanish, if you've taken either of these classes, you know that those languages have genders assigned to many nouns. And in German, a house key is masculine. And so Germans would describe keys as being cold and metal and jagged, and it's a tool, it's utilitarian. Whereas in Spanish, key is feminine. And they would often describe a key as being light and delicate. And I'm running low on my battery, as you can tell. Light, delicate, shiny, pretty. And so the way that they viewed the exact same object differed because of the gender that was assigned to it. Pretty fascinating. And then your last slide for today is just a concept of critical periods. We've talked about this a little bit with development. Recognize that a critical period is a period of time where it's incredibly important that you either are or are not exposed to some kind of stimulus, right? So we talked about this with teratogens. When a woman is pregnant, it's incredibly important that the developing human is not exposed to caffeine and mercury and things like that. Well, there are some critical periods with language as well. Those phonemes that we talked about, those basic sounds. Well, there's a lot of theory out there that if you are not exposed to phonemes in the first few years of your life, they become really difficult to replicate, which is why you might be in a foreign language class and the teacher says, repeat after me, and they say a word and you struggle to simply repeat the word. Whereas I could make up a word in using English phonemes, gabagalushka, and you can repeat that really easy because it's made up of English phonemes. And so if you aren't exposed to certain phonemes in the first few years of life, they can become really difficult to replicate. And so there are phonemes in German, for example, that's really hard for an English speaker to say. There's phonemes in English that's really hard for someone in Germany to say. So that's exposure to phonemes. Mastering a second language, certainly not impossible when you're an adult, but significantly more difficult. You really should be mastering a second or third language when you're learning your first language. By the time you hit high school, it becomes very, very difficult to master additional languages. And then finally, there's a guy named Lindbergh, and he believes that if we aren't exposed to language by puberty, then our ability to master language is near impossible. And so it's what he calls the critical period hypothesis. Specifically, if you're not exposed to language, you won't ever be able to learn it. Exposed to language by puberty, that is. And so this is not something we can test in a lab, right? We can't deprive someone of language for the first 12, 13 years of life just to see what would happen. However, in the 1970s, we did stumble across this young woman who we refer to as Jeannie, who was locked in a room for the first 13 years of her life with very, very little contact with anyone, including her own parents. And we're going to watch a video about Jeannie a little bit later this week and look at the critical period and see whether or not that supports Lindbergh's hypothesis or not. That's going to do it for this lecture today. If you have questions, I would encourage you to send me an email. And again, I hope you're doing well and take care.